All right, Athena, thank you very much. Let's bring in our panel to discuss all of this. We have CNN politics reporter and editor-at-large Chris Ciliza, Washington Post congressional reporter Karun Demirjian, and former U.S. Undersecretary for Political Affairs Ambassador Nicholas Burns. Great to have all of you. Ambassador Burns, let's just start with what Angela Merkel said about European nations may having to go it alone. This is based on her interactions with President Trump, what she heard President Trump say in front of NATO. How significant is this?
Allison, it's a very significant statement by the senior leader in Europe, the most experienced global leader today. She's reflecting the fact that there are profound differences right now between the Trump administration and Europe on trade, on Russia, definitely on climate change, and over NATO. And NATO has been the glue that has bonded us to the Europeans for 70 years. It took us all that time to build this great alliance. We have so much in common with the Europeans. They are fighting with us in Afghanistan. They're making sacrifices. They're fighting with us against the Islamic State. And I think it reflects the feeling that the administration is not prioritizing NATO. For some reason, the president confirmed the Article 5 security pledge to the Europeans when he was at NATO headquarters. And there is, I think, profound decline in American influence. And that's a sad day for all the Republicans and Democrats who have worked so hard since Harry Truman to build up this alliance. I think it's a very significant statement. It should be troubling to us because NATO is vital for the United States. We really need these allies.
Yeah, and Chris Ciliza, to pick up on that, I mean, it was John Meacham who commented over the weekend that not since pre-World War I have we seen a resurgent Russia, Germany talking about going it alone, and a more passive United States, a more America-first isolationist United States, and we know how that turned out. You're arguing that, in fact, the national security area, foreign affairs, is where Donald Trump may have his biggest influence yet. Negative influence, positive influence, or do we know?
I mean, we don't know. Like many things with Trump, I think we know he's willing to do and say things other politicians and presidents have not previously been willing to say and do, David. He represents unorthodoxy, uncertainty. And yeah, you know, I think we tend to focus, when we look at his slogan, Make America Great Again, there's a tendency to focus on the domestic policy. But the truth of the matter is, the ambassador can speak to this, is that you can always change more in terms of foreign policy than you can in terms of domestic policy as president. You're very circumscribed as a president in terms of domestic policy, largely through Congress. President Trump struggles with the health care bill, funding for his border wall. These are things we've seen already. But think about it. He's pulled out of the Trans-Pacific Partnership. We now see him waffling, certainly, on the Paris climate change accord. You can impact large-scale change. Now, you can't do everything. Obviously, treaties and that sort of thing Congress has a role in, but you can do many things. Keystone Pipeline, which we don't tend to think of as a foreign policy issue, but you know, certainly has that impact. His influence, I think, whether it's 4 years or 8 years, will be felt more powerfully, and I think Angela Merkel's comments speak to this, more powerfully in the way in which the U.S. views itself in the world and the way in which the world views the United States than anything he will do domestically. And I think that is a reality driven home by this last 9 days where he's been
abroad.
And just
to follow up on that, Karun, I mean, this is why you have a president who seems to admire strong men around the world for what they can achieve through those tactics rather than in concert with allies.
Right. It's just that he's running a very different country than most of those strong men are. Right. And in most of the other countries where you have those types of strong men leaders, you have a very weak judiciary, you have a legislative branch that exists largely to rubber stamp what the president wants to do. That's not the case here. And you have resistance to a lot of executive actions, even coming from members of his own party, or if not outright resistance, then, you know, disquietedness and the desire to assert themselves in their constitutional role. But certainly that, you know, Trump is not somebody who is not a diplomat who holds his words back, let's say. There is a style of diplomacy to what he's doing, but he's certainly very out there, and he's himself, and he hasn't changed that simply because he's entered the Oval Office.
So